And there you can see us flying in.
Those are whites, those are pink and white.
Right.
With a white parachute set into it, and that's what's happening as a theme on all the pink parachutes now. It'll be doubled up as pink and white if we've got the time.
Really, it just makes people feel more special. And when they come in, it's almost like coming into their own mind, coming into something that they knew existed somewhere, but it didn't till now.
There's a real culture where most people's experience of going out and seeing bands or going out and dancing is a matte black painted club.
Yeah.
Oh, where they go in and there's some flashing lights and some strobes going off every now and again. And
I think we're using a lot of almost childhood memories, birthday parties, that kind of feel, that sort of special drapery, special gift wrapping, almost changing something flat and masculine to something feminine and special and celebratory.
It's like there's a certain pride in dressing up for everybody and showing off our best clothes.
To go to Whirl-y-gig all the time, especially like we went to Phoenix and WOMAD. Like, I'm fucking embarrassed. Went to Phoenix and WOMAD, and so we haven't been to Whirl-y for ages, so we thought we'd come here and do it again. But it's nice as well, like here during the day, when you can go during the day and just sit in there and just sit and chat, and you recognise people, and it's nice. It's like a big youth club, that's what Whirl-y-gig's like. Big youth club. Isn't it? Everyone, you know, when you're little and you go to youth club and all your friends are there, and it's exactly what it's like, but it's just more grown up, isn't it?
It's unmixed music, which is a real, was a real eye-opener to me, because whenever you're DJing, it's all about mixing music, and it just stops you in your tracks and they can play a record from beginning to end, and it has to mean something.
Yeah. I just can't wait. I mean, I was on the ground yesterday, yeah, crying, because I was sort of listening to him do the sound set, and it just sounded so nice in there. I mean, if I was on the ground crying yesterday, I mean, what am I going to do today?
Under there.
That's
what she's doing, she's bringing it under the air. Gathered at the end so that it cold. No, just sweeping under the yellow, one fold.
One fold, which gets pinned.
So I need to move this.
Which gets pinned about where the green is.
Oh, yeah. The green meets the yellow.
Or a bit before.
Shall I put you over?
Mary,
hold on.
Okay. Mary, how's that?
Yeah. Up there.
I need a bit of space to get the table.
I loved it so much, I just went up to Mary and said, give us a job. And she said, all right then. And she did, she gave me a job. And I just thought, I can't believe this. I was being paid to sit on a fire exit. Well, I didn't sit, I danced, basically. And, you know, I went there every week anyway because I loved it. And then I was being paid to be there and have a good time, and I couldn't believe it.
It's kind of where all the misfits go, in a way. There's everyone's sort of story about how they came
and
to
how they came
gig.
There's
a kind of misfit quality to
it. You get cards from people that have come and gone that say, oh, I met so-and-so and they've been, and, you know, even at Whirl-y-gig at Shoreditch itself, we get people from, you know, top and bottom of the country, west and east. And
at Shoreditch, a lot of the main deck was up all the time, but originally it was go into this bare hall, transform it with decor, lights and sounds, an atmosphere, and take it all down and go away again.
And there's something about capturing that moment. It was like we've recently come back from Glastonbury, and we put, you know, we all go into it, you know, mad, put it all up, work really hard, put it all up for an evening, have a really good set, and then suddenly it all comes down again. And there were people at Glastonbury that were coming back into the tent, and it's almost like you look on their faces and it's like, did I dream it? Was it there last night?
Take it up and put it down every week and spend the summer doing this.
I'll tell you what's going on.
Lots of children in there, which is always lovely. It's nice for us. We have a lot of children on the crew, and it's nicer to feel good and safer about the environment you take your kids, you know. It's good for us, most of us, being able to work with our children.
How about you two girls?
Sorry?
Your two girls are really lovely.
Well, they enjoy this, you know. It's far better than Walt Disney could ever do for them, you know. It's a bit more real, something behind it. Bow.
I reckon you can find people out on a street, which you could call Whirl-y-gig at the heart, but that doesn't actually go to Whirl-y-gig because it's the way you are, it's the way you treat people around you. If you feel stressed up, they will sit down and talk to you about it, and they'll talk through it and whatever. You tend to get addicted to the place. It really does get addictive because it really, I could call it 4 hours of absolute utopia for, like, every week you get this little 4 hours and you just don't want to miss it because it's just, it feels amazing.
Get this really overwhelming feeling that you just get goosebumps and your hair stands up on end and really feel happy. And you just can't get there anywhere else. It's like when you listen to music, you can sometimes get it back again and you get the goosebumps. But it's not the same as being at Whirl-y-gig and seeing everyone else have that same feeling as well. Took my mum just a couple of weeks after I'd first been. I knew she'd like it, and got there and it was quite dark when we were queuing up.
And eventually the door opened, and Leary on the door, he knew it was my first one. I don't know how he did, but he said to me, "You'll really love it. Have a good time." And I went through the door, and the music was playing, and something just happened. I've never experienced anything quite like it.
Yeah, well, I've been to Whirl-y-gig for around 5 years now. But I've been working there about 4 years. No, about 4.5 years. I met Mary and Richard at the psychology conference, the humanistic conference, and got on fine with them. And so then I lost my job. And then they asked me if I wanted to work. So, I've been working there ever since. And,
it was an idea in someone's mind, you know, that there needed to be a place that was more free and more relaxed. This is all third hand, because I wasn't actually there at the time. But, yeah, the idea needed following, and there's this... The person whose idea it was in the Association for Humanistic Psychology.
They wanted something clearly celebratory. The notion of celebration of who we are and what we do and what we achieve and being alive was felt to have been either rubbed out or tainted in normal society. There were two or three people involved. A woman, Ros Madden, was one of the key ones who actually started it the first year it ran, when the Whirl-y-gig was very small. But very soon after that, Richard joined it. Well, he went to it because he enjoyed it, and gradually he began to run it.
You know, a lot of clubs, you run clubs. If you're normal, you run a club at the end of the telephone, really, and you book people to do those things, you know, and you get your counts right and it all works out, and then you've got a club, and that's how most people would do it. But, you know, that's just, you know, wasn't our approach, you know, it was just like we were doing it ourselves at every stage. So at every stage we were developing the details in every direction. I mean, this is particularly obvious when we went to Notre Dame Hall. People used to talk about this. We used to walk straight off Leicester Square, the heart of the West End, you know, up the side street, down this innocuous door into Wonderland, into Whirl-y-gig. Now in Shoreditch, you walk off this grey, dusty, one-way East End street into this apparently grey, dusty building into Wonderland, and it's Whirl-y-gig. And somehow the contrast lends power to what you're doing.
Yeah, he hasn't come back yet. I'm waiting for him anyway, he's soon come.
One of the things we've always talked about is how peaceful it is, you know. Everybody seems to get on. It's just a friendly atmosphere. And that's one thing I admire, because that's quite different from most functions you go to that so many young people are involved in.
Sometimes you get customers, like, ringing up, or maybe who's heard about Whirl-y-gig, and they'll ask you details on dressing or what it's like and everything. You can start by saying a few things, but at the end of the day, you just have to turn around and say it's best if you see it for yourself, because it's not something that you can describe, because you can't.
There's no special way to dance either.
No, it's funny.
Freak out.
But you see, it's much more awkward for us, because I've been on duty.
Yeah, that's the only thing. It's good for exercise as well. Yeah,
that's the only thing, is that you can't join in so much. But I mean, I have broken rules and I have gone up there and I've had a dance.
It was a shock to suddenly be thrust in amongst them all and actually to be on a working relationship with them rather than as a punter, which I had been before. And then I went away to Vancouver for 2 months and came back and came to the Whirl-y just to say hello to everybody. And after being there for some 3 or 4 weeks, Mary said if I wanted a job, I could have one. So, about the last 18 months, I've been working.
What are you working on now?
With the Whirl-y, I'm doing sort of the main production crew. I come in the afternoon, I rig up the actual gig. I then blow up balloons to put in the main hall, and then during the evening I steward the gig, make sure everybody's having a good time, make sure there's no problems, that everything runs smoothly and everybody has fun. I don't like a lot of other clubs. I worked as a barman in a club once and found the whole atmosphere very nasty, but working with the Whirl-y is completely different. It's a lot more fun, it's a lot more... It's like going out with your friends. You meet up, you talk, you put on a good gig for everybody, and then afterwards you'll sit around and chat. And I think it's more of a way of life than a club.
She's kind of dry.
Yeah, her and Kate are kind of dry. That'd be excellent.
Well, a normal Saturday at Whirl-y-gig starts with the sacred hour, and that's where the main body of the crew who do the rigging all day and stay to the end, they arrive at 2 o'clock. It's quite exciting, there's a buzz in the air during the sacred hour. And we're all together and we're going to do the Whirl-y-gig again, you know, and it's the cycle of the week has come around to that point again. And we all really like it, and we're all ready.
Did I introduce you to Whirl-y-gig?
Yeah.
Possibly. I think so, maybe. I think I've got a vague recollection of sitting on a stage with Lisa, actually, and being a bit stuck for things to say. Lisa was the very first person I met in London, and it was pouring with rain, and she had an umbrella and she shared it with me. Sweet, but there you go, in the middle of mayhem of Camden Market, found love.
I left home when I was 17, which was quite young. I was one of the runaways, and I came to London to make it good, you know, to kind of grow up and stuff, and I felt very isolated. The Whirl-y-gig group kind of offered me like a family support group of people who really cared about each other and do care about each other, you know.
I think that's something that Whirl-y-gig does provide is that a space somehow that is really, really good. A lovely space for healing, really. No. It's just that
it's very strange.
You arrive with baggage and troubles and you leave feeling a lot lighter. And it's just like that.
Doing social work during the week carries forward to Whirl-y-gig to an extent because of my work in Whirl-y-gig, which is a general sort of checking that everybody's okay, really. Part of the smaller group at Whirl-y-gig is emanating that to eyes everywhere, you know, no corners where there's anyone that's, you know, not okay. So I suppose I carry my social work skills to Whirl-y-gig as well, but Whirl-y-gig is a whole different experience than working in the community, as we said.
Since last year, but I started coming regularly in November, since November, every Saturday.
What makes you want to be the first?
I don't know what it is, it's just something I have to do. I feel a compelling need to do it every Saturday.
I mean, Whirl-y-gig to me isn't a nightclub. People say, do you go to a nightclub? I said, no, I go to Whirl-y-gig.
Whirl-y-gig is much more than a nightclub. It's a social event where everyone just comes together and it's just changed my life, basically.
It has completely changed mine, like, totally. From before, I mean, I've always had a happy life, but, I mean, there have just always been, like, things that worry me and, you know, just make me really confused about life and myself and other people and other people's attitudes towards me and how I should act to them. But since coming to Whirl-y, I mean, since meeting, like, Tommy especially, because he's really sorted me out a lot, you know, it's just, I've just come to realise those different things and I've come to take life just as a much more happy place. I mean, I used to be really morbid about it.
It sort of teaches you how to, I mean, my first experience at Whirl-y-gig, I was dancing with my best friend up on, just on the dance floor. I'd never been here before, didn't know what to expect. And this bloke walks past me and he comes back and he turns to me and he gave me a hug, he goes, welcome to Whirl-y-gig. And I just thought at that time that was, and it's just continued like that for the rest of the time I've come here. Just people who you don't know just giving you something which you can't get in everyday life.
I mean, since coming here, I have never, ever seen any bad feelings at Whirl-y, ever. I mean, I think it's one of the best, most exciting spiritual places in the entire world. It's just so special.
Do you remember me? No.
It's Annie. Charlie.
Thank you.
Stop there.
Contention how long we've been anywhere, you know. It's like Whirly time is not ordinary time, especially on the actual night, you know. It's like you're stepping into a new sort of time frame, or it's a different, you know. It's like the whole idea of Whirly is you go into it and it's a whole experience, a whole environment that's different from ordinary life, so consequently it does shift how you are and how you perceive other people, and you know what time is. It is a bit like a roller coaster ride, and all your values and that are shifted around, and you know people smile at you and people come up to you, and you know there's an acceptance there, which we encourage. You know, we try and encourage a safety for people coming there and try and look after people, because they do take drugs. You know, I mean there's a lot of drug taking goes on outside the gig, and they'll come in. And it can be a really scary place, but we're quite experienced at looking after people and making sure they all feel like we're looking after them.
you know, chill out rooms downstairs. They haven't turned the cold water taps off in the bathroom, which other places do.
You don't need to be competitive. You don't need to be grabbing or getting. People aren't there to win something over on somebody else or to pick somebody up. They're just there to be and often to give.
Being with a lot of people and dancing to the same rhythm, I mean, that's really important, the dancing. It, for me, is a lot of what releases that tension and lets people be good to each other, be nice to each other.
Because I mean, you imagine Whirl-y-gig, the same atmosphere with the same people with, I don't know, hard techno or something going on. The whole atmosphere would change, and yet you've got the same people and the same place to be in.
The actual music that is used is mainly world music. There's a lot of rhythms from other cultures that are brought into the dance tracks, such that people are definitely affected by the rhythms very, very strongly. Mm. And the pace builds up during the course of the evening. And both the psychological effects of music, harmony and rhythm, the fact that it's world music seems to tie right into the spirit that's created in the room.
You just walk out feeling as good as you did before you were going in. You have the same feeling of the excitement. You know, whirly butterflies is what we all talk about before we're going. Everyone gets the whirly butterflies just before you're going in, but you still have them when you come out.
So the mice and mice kind of work as
a quartet.
Yeah.
You know what you're doing,
don't you? Yeah. The mice and mice kind of work as a quartet. So there's a general scheme in which Graham will have a more general idea of the scheme, which he'll let Rose know and you two know as you come up. Arvin, you'll go and see Rose. Izzy, you'll go and see Graham. And,
Are you ready?
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 Are you
Okay.
I was working at Oxford on my Duke of Edinburgh, and I had a teddy sale there. And when I was working there for 6 weeks, and by the time I left, no one bought him, so I took him home.
Isn't that a nice story? He was waiting for somebody special to come along and take him home, but you didn't tell him what happened after that, did you? What you did to him?
It's quite so nice,
he took him home, and on the way home, he squashed his...
No, no, on the way here.
On the way here, he squashed his head in the train doors. That's what he did.
He wanted a different view of the world, you see.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
Yes,
Richard.
Oh, excellent. Put the sock on his head. That's it.
We do ask 14-year-olds to bring their parents, and we try to make their parent feel very welcome and make a bit of a fuss of them. And I often take them backstage, and we have very candid conversations about drugs and, you know, the real issues, the sort of risks that a 14-year-old, you know, London's nightlife might come across. So we talk to their parents about it, and we say, but, you know, if you tell them about drugs, and we talk to them about drugs, and if they're going to take drugs somewhere, if they end up taking drugs at Whirl-y-gig, at least they're going to be well looked after when they have, you know, and they're going to be given all of the sort of information on drugs by us, if not by their parents.
Thank you.
daddy, and so I think they've just gone for a little dance, haven't they, on the dance floor, while we look after you for a little while, and then they're coming straight back. But Naomi, she just looked round and they were gone. Rory, could you come and say hello to Naomi in the office, please? Would that be all right, over?
Just changing Ollie in the crew
room. Look, he's next door. Well, we didn't know he was there. Come on, we could go next door and see him. Oh, we get there. I mean, he's only two doors.
Well, we haven't found Joe yet, but we found Rory. Because Rory's in the next room. He's in his next room.
And Mummy's just downstairs, dancing. We'll find her.
Well, I'll come down and check anyway.
especially the Lindsay Hall community.
Yeah, you're watching them and you've got this like sense of awe and wonderment.
People are sharing in their energy. Originally, this energy, you could only get it by going out to the festivals. In the past, you had to go out to the festivals, which was a nature thing, where the green type awareness comes out, like a shamanistic energy where people dance around, trance, and it was just drumming and beats. If someone had a conversation with me directly after I'd just been in that trance, the things that I could talk to them about, which I didn't even realise that I had an opinion on, but I could see things so clearly.
It all comes down to self-empowerment. Yeah. You know, going to somewhere like the Whirl-y-gig and just feeling free and being at one with yourself is an empowering thing. It's a growing thing, you know, when you actually start saying, I am responsible for this earth, I am responsible for my way of living. It's self-empowerment for the individual, and things like the Whirl-y-gig do that.
Yeah.
Festivals do that, it's living in the community.
I think it's a good thing is that when you see someone that you absolutely don't know, and you see this person needs something, and you know, need a massage, for example, and you go to this person and you give a massage, and it's like, you know, you give exactly what this person needed, and
it's
as good for you as for this person.
And one day this guy gave me an apple fruit when I was there, and I thought, oh, that's cool, I think I'll buy a packet. So the week before WOMAD last year, bought a packet, and it's like, you can't eat a packet when you're in there, it's just too disgusting. So I turned around and started giving away apple fruits, and then Andy said, you've just found your vacation.
There's no thinking about sharing and giving. Even here, we live in a community of cooperative, and we're not, we try, but we don't have the, it's bravery, I suppose. It's the courage to go up and sort of go like that with someone.
Even if you start off with an opal fruit, it's like a training thing, because once you've given that, then if something else comes up outside of the wedding gig, you might even feel, well, actually, I can do something. Oh, all right, I can. Whereas before, you would have been so guarded, so sort of like closed up. You'd say, oh no, nothing to do with me, I can't help, what do you want?
Yeah.
It's like a safe place to practice your wings. And this is why I say it grows. When you come out of the world again, the lifestyle, the ideas, the sort of attitude, permeates out.
Yeah,
and then someone you meet, you give them something, and maybe they'll give someone else something.
Yeah,
all started from the Whirly.
Yeah.
All of us are able to do that with or without Whirly gig. Whirly gig helps us. But
yes.
I tell you, if I could in the my whole life in the
Thank you.
daughter Linda, I love to dance. I love to dance, and I thought, I'm not too old to dance, and everyone else deals with young people. And she said, come to Whirl-y-gig, Mum. She had a boyfriend here at the time. She still has a boyfriend here, but and she said, come and dance. So I went and danced, and then we were asked to do the cloakroom, and it just went from there.
The unique thing about Whirl-y is the people love our club, and they love us, and we love them. Simple.
Simple.
Lots of love here.
Lots of love. Lots of love.
Ooh. Do you want a doggy one?
I get certain guilt trips about going out to places like Whirl-y-gig and having an excellent time and spending money on it and doing things like that and everything, because it's just knowing that there's people somewhere that don't get all that, you know. And not just that, but people somewhere that have like everything they ever had taken away from them, which I don't mean just in a material way, but everything they've ever had, like, you know, their family, their friends, happiness they had, maybe even, you know. Since I came from Bosnia, first year was terrible. I've been rejected really bad. Second year, I started going to the other college. But then people over there were really sort of, you know, it was really important what you're into and what sort of, like, what's your style or image. In Whirl-y-gig, I just came and people didn't bother about any of those things. The only one thing that really bugs me sometimes is the paranoia of Whirl-y-gig being a fake. You know, that's because I haven't been going to Whirl-y-gig for long enough to be able to judge it, you know. But I would be so, so disappointed in everything if I ever found out that Whirl-y-gig was a bit of a fake, you know. But I guess Whirl-y-gig can't be a fake, because Whirl-y-gig is the people that come to the place, you know. And I doubt that out of whatever amount of people that come there, everyone is a fake, you know. That's just impossible. So there must be a certain group of people in Whirl-y-gig that are definitely not a fake. And the best example I could give is Tommy, the wizard. He's just definitely on the vibe.
About 4 years ago, I went through the worst time of my life where, I mean, my life didn't mean anything to me. I mean, I tried committing suicide twice, but now, because I did that, I have such an appreciation for life. If I hadn't done that, I wouldn't be who I am today. It's going through that and coming out of it. It's like from what I went before, being at one stage of sort of lying, to what I am now, to sort of, I mean, I feel no anger towards anything. I'm not angry, I don't get angry at anyone. I mean, all I feel is love all the time for everyone. I mean, I do love the whole world. Sometimes people find it hard to accept, you know, how can he do that? See, music plays a vital role in it as well, because what music does, it lifts you up, it lifts your spirits up, and the lights that do that as well. But when you look beyond everything, all the lights, all the music, you can see that just everyone's joined together. I mean, that is the place where I just feel so much connection. That's one of the reasons I go there every Saturday as well, just to do that. So just to sort of you know, just basically give out all my love to everyone, and I can do that there so easily. It's just so, I mean, it's like there's a place that can change you, can change your life forever. I mean, when a place can do that, that place is just so amazing. So I think it does help so much. It's part of, it's like a focus point, if you see what I mean, that brings out everyone, lets people find themselves more like. I mean, I've totally found myself. That's one place that I found myself at, found my own place in life and everything.
Hey, Jane, Rory. Can you do a count of the scrims that we got back here, just for my own curiosity? Yeah, that'd be good.
Also, is Clive still about? Is he still doing something?
He's been a while since we did something.
Fair enough. Okay, no problem.
Arvin,
you know when you're taking these, if you take these lanterns down,
yeah,
could you tie them up? You know, like in a knot so that they don't come loose and get all tangled, you know?
Yes.
So just something like tie them tight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Personal experience of trance, Whirl-y-gig, is I just know what light's right, and I have too many intuitive correctnesses with putting on, bringing in lights and things like that, for me to believe that it's my little conscious ego going, oh yes, that's the right decision.
I think I always think that, particularly with the parachute set, is that everything comes together, the lights all come down onto the parachute. You know, the parachute is it for that time. And I can get into a trance-like state on that parachute very easily because of the lights, because of the music, and because of the spirit that is around that parachute with everybody's focus, everybody's, you know, it can induce that kind of state. You don't need acid, you don't need, you know.
In a real sense, you don't. You're being fed with energy the entire time, because the energy you put into this gig that goes to the dancers on the dance floor, or myself on the lights, or Jin doing 101 different roles as she does, for all of us, the energy we're putting in, we're in a sense reaping from the atmosphere, from other people, from the atmosphere, from the whole, the whole human,
because
thing.
Ultimately it's the people that make it, isn't it? It's us, it's the people that come.
It is.
That makes Whirl-y-gig what it is.
And some bloody good projectors.
These are old Avalon Ballroom family dog postcards from old 60s gigs that I wish I'd been to, but I was not born, well, maybe just born. I wish I'd been there. I've got records of some of them, quite a lot of the band, but never, you can never get Richard playing any old Pink Floyd or Jimi Hendrix anything now. What else do I need? Bag to put it all in. Hello. Yeah, speaking. Hello, David. I didn't know you were going to be back today. Well, I can't come into the office today because we're getting ready to go to WOMAD and I've got a lot of people waiting. Yeah, I've finished doing up the study now and it's all decorated and I've got my big desk in there and it's all set up for working. I'm not really sure what you want done with that, so I'm just going on with the carbon chapter. And then hopefully when I've done that, get on with the efficiency.
They're not too bad. I mean, they accept what I do and they say, well, it's your life, do what you like, and they give me their blessing, which is really good of them, because I know a lot of people's parents wouldn't do the same. It shouldn't be like that. I mean, Whirl-y-gig's given me so much pleasure and joy in the past, and I know it gives a lot of pleasure to other people, and I just see everyone, how happy everyone is when they're here. It's a real kind of thing that brings people together.
Thank you. to actually be, you know, accepted as a part of what they do and go to the events and perform, and that is, you know, as the biggest buzz in itself, you know. I mean, all the other areas which sort of get forgotten about when the music's blaring out and everyone's in the hall having a good time, you know, all of those different aspects of the crew, when you're inside it and you see what all of them do and have to keep together, and, you know, they are running an organised business, you know, very efficiently and very well, and they're also very attentive towards their audience. I mean, they've got it just right.
Hello, Karen. I've got a minute. Could I speak to you? It's Mary from Whirl-y-gig
over. Yeah, hello, Mary. This is Pat here. Thanks very much. The early Whirl-y-gigs were basically a sound system, a space and a group of people. It was really simple, it always was, and the people that came to it prided themselves and that's all they needed. And the basic attitude was that they would ideally be dancing before they'd taken their coat off. And that's what they were there to do, and that's what they did. And I like the name Monkey Pilot, and it sort of seemed to say a lot about, so do you want some tea? It seems to say a lot about how I felt. You know, how you feel one minute you're in control, another minute you're not really. Or are you, you know, that sort of thing. But there have been times when I can get stuck at a place for hours. It can be in the middle of the night, and more often than not, I don't finish before 4 o'clock in the morning, before the Whirl-y-gig, and sometimes even later. It's really fortunate how just things evolved. Myself and a friend, Roger, introduced the parachute to Whirl-y-gig. We used to use it as youth and community workers. We used to use it with kids, you know, using parachute to play with kids. Hey, I want to come that way. And other times we'd throw it out to the audience for them to play with. And from that, our decor design has evolved. And the parachute at the end of the night has happened. But that has evolved too. So that just came from one parachute that was originally used to play with kids. Get
up. The monkey's gone bang. What else is it? This is a monkey.
Danny.
Thank you.
bracelet says Whirl-y-gig here. And I really like it artistically, its colours and everything. And it's very strong, you know. But when I look at it, it's a bit like a tag, isn't it? You know, and I don't know who owns it, whether I own the bracelet or the bracelet owns me, you know. But then I think it doesn't really matter with Whirl-y-gig, really, you know.
You do belong to something.
Yeah, yeah, I don't mind belonging to Whirl-y-gig. I don't mind if Whirl-y-gig owns me, even, you know, because I feel like my spirit is part of Whirl-y-gig, anyway, you know.
The introduction of the parachute at Whirl-y-gig, I think, was pure genius. To me, it offers something which is at once both terrifying, you know, being under the middle of that parachute, not being able to get out, the whole world seems to move, and you with it. And at the same time, it's also totally encasing, totally holding and encompassing, and therefore very, very safe. So it enables, I don't want to put it too mystically, but it enables boundaries to dissolve and float out and come back again. I think this is a very therapeutic thing.
The first time that I first went to Whirl-y-gig and this parachute appeared from like nowhere, and everyone just started falling over and I was just sort of squashed behind all these people. It happened so quickly, but it was only a couple of minutes of not knowing what was going to happen, and then you realise, well, of course it has to happen like this. It couldn't possibly come down from the ceiling. After the half an hour, it's just taken away, it's just gone, and everyone's just left there, still talking to each other, still quite calm, and people gradually get up and walk away. And some people stay there for quite a while afterwards.
People need that. People need it. You know, I needed something before I started going to Whirl-y-gig, you know. And I found Whirl-y-gig, and you know, 2 days before Whirl-y-gig is on, from Thursday onwards, I'm just sitting there like this, you know, waiting for it to happen kind of thing, you know.
Everybody does their best because they love it. They enjoy the evening. They enjoy the look on people's faces. They get there, wow, my God. And then, you know, people are just blown away by all this. You think, well, hey, that was kind of like, that was us. We all did this. So you take pride in it. You don't feel the need to work, or, you know, you get told off. You do it because you want to do it.